Of course, John Arezzi's Pro Wrestling Spotlight then and now, where John Arezzi and myself go back and review the original broadcast of Pro Wrestling Spotlight, his landmark wrestling radio show from 30 years ago. We are right now in 1991, a packed episode, a lot of news, a lot of things happening. John, just back from Joel Goodhart's TWA Winter Challenge 2, which opened with Al Perez pinning Stan Lane, managed by Jim Cornette.
I remember that.
But while there, and this is a night you, I'm sure, remember, the Sheik versus Abdullah the Butcher, Cactus
Well, that's
Jack.
What, I'm glad they put us on first, because I was there, Dennis Corluzzo was there, and Frank Chili was there, and we're going out to Ribbit afterwards, but I stayed to watch the show because I wanted to see Sheik and Abdullah.
According to reports on this broadcast from 1991, Stan Lane and Jim Cornette, monster pop coming out in Philadelphia to open up the show. But one of the other matches that was legendary in its time on the indie scene, Cactus Jack and Eddie Gilbert, a pretty famous feud.
Two out of three matches.
Oh, that wasn't this night. This was just a false count anywhere.
That's right. That's right. They were setting it up.
Well, I have some audio I want to play for you, Jim. And, you know, one of the things people still talk about is Eddie Gilbert as a mind, his booking mind, the things that he wanted to do, what could have been if he had lived. And of course, we also have heard about the paranoia and his political problems everywhere he went, and he constantly talks about it. It's all on display. He is on this episode of Pro Wrestling Spotlight Then and Now, where we review the original broadcast. But I wanted to play you a little bit of this Eddie interview and get your thoughts. It's going to cut for a second where the tape got turned over, but I'm sure you'll understand what John and Eddie are talking about here. Again, March 1991. We'll talk about this on the other side.
Finally, this promotion, in particular Tri-State Wrestling, the way the wrestling business is today, a lot of people hope it goes back to the territories the way it used to be. What do you see the future of wrestling being, let's say, the next 3 to 4 years? I know it's in a crucial period. Honestly, as best as you can answer it, where do you see wrestling heading?
I think it's going to be a lot different than what we all expect. And I think, and I'll just be very honest with you, I think that the newsletters, the sheets, whatever everybody wants to call them or whatever, will have a big major factor play into it in the future. I think the wrestling fans will change. I think we're going to have a changeover of fans of what we know as wrestling fans. I think we'll see, as the 90s go, wrestling will definitely change, and a lot of people will be more up to what we're doing. But we're going to have a lot more respect, I think, from people than what we have. And when we have so many people saying, oh, this guy knows that, and let's protect this and protect that.
I just want to touch on that just before I let you go, is that shows like myself that I do each and every weekend, the Dave Meltzer newsletters, a lot of people say it's hurt the business. But as I had on my program last week, when Steiner Brothers win a World Tag Team title 4 days before the team they won it from actually won it, you know?
Well, it's Paco.
Who exposes the business?
Yeah, that's mostly, it's somebody that's either in a bad mood that says that house went down from the week before, or it's, I'll be very honest with you, it's a guy that's been in the business too long, and I hope that I represent, and I know a lot of people do, the new generation that doesn't see it that way, and I don't see it that way. I don't see how anything has hurt us. Your show, the newsletters, go to the wrestling public, love our business, and these people will pay anything to come and see us. And they want to sit around and talk. They don't want to come in and say, badmouth us. They want to help our business.
The crowd, like, was out there tonight watching, and I was there, and I felt more like a fan tonight than I have in many, many years, seeing your match with Cactus Jack that went all over the arena, looking at the cuts in your head. I think the people that are at this particular show, I think there needs to be more of them in wrestling. How do we attract these types of fans back?
I don't know, because you don't find too many people like up in this area. Northeast is such a different group of wrestling fans than anywhere else, especially Philadelphia or New York City, somewhere like that. You're not going to find any more different fans that way anywhere, not in the South, not anywhere else. Actually, to be very honest with you, the fans up here is the only thing that's really kept the hardcore wrestling fans alive.
Yeah,
if it wasn't for this group, and you know the group I'm talking about, just the group of people from the wrestling magazines, newsletters, shows like yourself, it wouldn't be that still that bond, that closeness. It wouldn't be anything.
So, Jim, what are your thoughts hearing Eddie's opinion on the future of wrestling and on the smart fan scene in 1991?
Well, I like the way he was beating around the bush. Yeah, up here in New York and Philly, the fans are different. You don't find fans like these anywhere else, because that was the first enclave of smart fans that were coming, that knew what was going on, but came to, you know, see what was going on. A lot of guys just went apeshit over Dave's newsletter and any of the newsletters or any of the radio shows. I didn't freak out about the newsletters too much because that was a specific audience that had to subscribe, that had to go out of their way to find the Observer or these newsletters. They were generally already people who knew what was going on anyway, who were quote unquote smart to the business. The radio shows, I got to be honest with you, that made me nervous because you can just be in the car driving down the road and hear that and get information that you might not be equipped to handle. Because that we've talked about this, you and I, before. The early smart fans were more equipped to handle the news that wrestling was a work in some cases than the boys were when they got them into business and smartened them up. Because the fans already, they respected and loved the business and didn't want to do anything to hurt it, and they kayfabed more than that. This was in the 90s at a time when Vince wasn't kayfabing and the fucking idiot corporate America, you know, got involved in Atlanta and weren't kayfabing. So the fans at that point, the smart fans, were taking better care of the business. And I think Eddie appreciated it. Eddie knew that the newsletters were, if he could get them on his side, then it was good publicity for him to get a booking job, because that's Eddie always wanted to book. And you know, we've talked about that before. And they ended up in Atlanta when Herd was listening to Steve Beverly and those guys, that was instrumental in getting guys positions. But what's come along in the 30 years since that was that the radio shows, instead of being on an AM radio station early on a Saturday morning or whatever, imagine now you're bombarded 24 hours a day from every direction with wrestling is phony. And that's what's led to what we've got today. So he had some pretty perceptive comments for 1991 and how things were going to change and et cetera, but nobody could have dreamed that everybody in the entire business would just give up and just run their mouth and just blurt out everything, and that here we'd be 30 years later. I was afraid of it. I didn't ever think all the fucking boys in the business and the promoters would do it. But I thought, you know, when enough people get smart to the wrestling business, where are we going to be? It's pointless to do it anymore. And that's pretty much is what happened. Is now 30 years later, everybody knows everything, and it's a television product to appeal to a very small niche audience, as they say. And from we thought it was almost as bad in the early 90s as it could ever get. We'd kill for that kind of business these days.
Hear more from Eddie Gilbert and so much more. Pro Wrestling Spotlight then and now. Look for it wherever you find your favorite podcasts, or go to pwspod.com to get access to each and every episode. John Arezzi's Pro Wrestling Spotlight then and now.